following is a presentation of HBO Sports.
Some sounds booming out of Jeep where I'm from. Cocoons hide the youth. Twin units 100 proof. You want some beef? They will cut you some where I'm from. The beats is infinite where I'm from. Voodoo, Ashu, Benin, gangsta lean where I'm from. I'm interplanetary. My insect movements vary. It's kinky if it's hair. Jeep where I'm from. The fire hoses blow. It's purple when it's snow. I do a hip.
This my mom, Deborah.
What's hip? When hip is just the norm. Cause planets pledge allegiance to the funk and all its
my mom, we got a like a love-hate relationship. Yeah. We got a love-hate relationship.
Told you, I'm gonna get him.
And this one? Them universal beats. Crazy. Always in my pocket. She got a hand in my pocket right now. Y'all just can't see it.
Look at she had to pull it out.
Look at it. She for real. My son, Takari, Amir Crawford.
Gonna be coming soon. About to drop. I got 4 kids already.
Ooh, 2 girls, 2 boys.
So that'd be 5. And I'm done.
Wicked big plans, got team. Where I'm from, it's Collins 13. Where I'm from, brothers took the beats and got fly.
Every fighter's story begins somewhere, but only some are truly defined by those origins. Welcome to North Omaha, Nebraska. Welcome to the tale of Terence Crawford. It is a harsh contrast, the cornfields of the American heartland and the roughest section of Omaha, Nebraska, where the streets are riddled with gangs and violence. But when Terence Crawford Jr., known best in these parts as Bud, was born here in 1987, he appeared to be well equipped to survive and even flourish in his surroundings.
Bud came out with his hands balled up. And his daddy said, "We got $1 million baby boy." And I said, "We ain't got shit."
When I seen Bud was just Bud. but his daddy and his uncle was boxer, so.
And his grandpa.
And his grandpa, so Bud gonna go out there and knock some heads off. I said he gonna be one little bad boy.
What you tell him to watch out for? What you used to tell him to watch out for?
Oh, I just tell him, you know, watch that left. He didn't watch the left, and I come around, boom. Maybe that stuck with Bud. Watch that left.
By the time Crawford turned 7, his combative personality was already defining him.
I stayed in trouble as a kid, getting in fights, fighting people outside of school. It was just rough. I was a little tempered kid for some reason.
Yeah, he always was a fighter. So I used to pay the kids in the neighborhood, get y'all $5, y'all can whoop Bud. Couldn't none of them whoop him, but I gave him $5 anyway. None of them whooped him, man. He was little then.
It was fortuitous then that the house behind Crawford's belonged to a man who ran a local boxing club and helped kids get off the streets. His name was Carl Washington.
I found him out my back door. He was one of the little kids that was running up and down the alley. So I wanted to talk to him about boxing. You know, your uncle boxed for me, your dad boxed for me, you know, and I know your grandpa very well. I don't talk to people. And so he just ran right past me and ran on in the house, you know. So I just walked right past my yard and walked into their house, you know, and knocked on the door.
Bud ran in the house and said, "Mom, some man want me to box for him." So I get up and come to the door. I said, "Oh, that's Carl Washington." And Carl asked me, "Can Bud box for him?" And I told Carl, yep, he sure can.
His first time sparring, he sparred right in that corner right there. And the first time he got hit, he started crying. And then he went ballistic on the guy in the ring, you know. And he showed a lot of heart, and he didn't stop. We had to say, "Hey, this is boxing. This is not for real," you know. So we had to slow him down, but we knew he had heart. That's how it started.
Well, it was something in him, you can see it in him, but it took a while for us to realize what he had and what it was.
At the time, the young fighter's father, Terence Sr., was serving in the Navy and only a distant presence. But the void would be filled by a member of the staff at Carl Washington's boxing club, a trainer named Midge Miner.
I used to make him go to my house and watch fight films, you know, and that's how we used to get along.
Midge would come to my house after I get out of school and take me to his house to the gym because he didn't want me in trouble. He was more than a mentor. He was like my dad because my dad wasn't there.
I changed him around his directions and things, you know, and he pretty much would listen to me, so I didn't have too much problems with him. And then really after he started growing up and got a little older, he was really listening to me.
By 2006, Crawford's team determined he was ready for wider exposure. Perfect timing, with the National Golden Gloves Amateur Tournament taking place in Omaha.
3,000 people came in, supported me every day. It was just a crowd chanting my name, Terence, Terence, Terence. And I could just always hear my aunt, "Send him home, bud, send him home."
He made it to the final, but then fell short of the championship in a close decision.
I had fun, you know. It was a good experience. But this ain't gonna do nothing but make me stronger. I'll be back.
Staying in the amateur ranks, Crawford next began training for the Beijing Olympic Games. But at the Olympic trials, he came up short once again.
Yeah, it's over with. I'm just about to turn pro.
That was my next question. What's next for you?
Yeah, turn professional. Look out for me.
Crawford made his professional debut in March of 2008. But 6 months later, it was an evening away from the ring when his life changed forever. He'd been shooting dice with a dangerous crowd in North Omaha, and then returned to his parked car to count his winnings from the game.
I got shot right here. I got hit with the first shot, and I was just like, damn. I was like, man, I'm shot. It was blood everywhere. It was blood all over my car. When it stopped, I looked up, and that's when everybody was just like, man, go to the hospital.
They told me he was lucky because I guess the bullet went in and bounced off or something.
That head was hard.
Yep.
The doctors said I was lucky, being that the distance that the projectile was fired from and the window that made the bullet tumble, instead of going straight, that it was God. Because I wasn't the only one that got shot that night. A friend got shot and it shattered his whole arm. And I just got lucky.
They say it's lonely at the top in whatever you do. You always gotta watch motherfuckers around you. Nobody's invincible, no plan is foolproof. We all must meet our moment of truth. The same shiesty cats that you hang with and do your thing with could set you up and wet you up. Nigga, peep the language, it's universal. You play with fire, it may hurt you or burn you. Lessons are blessings you should learn through, let's face facts. Although MCs lays tracks, it doesn't mean behind the scenes there ain't no dirt to trace back.
Well, after I got shot in the head, I was just mad. All I was thinking about was who shot me and what I was gonna do to him when I caught him. And I would go talk to my uncle because he would see that something was always on my mind.
Actions have reactions, don't be quick to judge. You may not know the hardships people don't speak of. It's best to step back and observe with coup, for we all must meet our moment of truth.
Crawford's uncle, DeArthur Davis, a preacher in North Omaha, had long been another of the young fighter's trusted mentors.
When Terence got shot, one of the questions I asked him, what do you want out of life? What is your goal? What is your purpose? You lucky. It could have been a lot worse than it was.
The situation that I'm facing is mad amazing. To think such problems can arise from minor confrontations.
But God and his angels were looking over you, and he's giving you another chance. He got a purpose for you, and the chance is that, hey, this here was a mistake, but now you can move on. And with that mark of getting shot, when you touch that scar on your head, you always know that you are blessed.
They say it's lonely at the top in whatever you do. You always gotta watch motherfuckers around you. No one is untouchable, no man is bulletproof. We all must meet our moment of truth.
Bud told me that if he keep up running with his friends and stuff, that he's gonna end up in the penitentiary or the graveyard. That, you know, that taught him a lesson, so it must have did something to his head, because he started, you know, starting to get a little bit better. You know, he kicked him to the curb, you know.
Among those to whom Crawford turned was Bryan McIntyre, a close family friend who'd become his full-time trainer when he turned pro.
After he got shot, you seen the change in his lifestyle. He started respecting people or the streets more than he really did. Because you never know what's gonna be out there, and he understood that. So he changed his crowd, he changed where he went. He was more dedicated to the gym, he was more dedicated to his craft.
In late 2010, a call came from Palm Springs, California. Timothy Bradley wanted to hire Crawford as a sparring partner in advance of his championship fight with Devin Alexander.
Sparring Tim is what really got people to take notice of me, because at first people was looking at me like a bar fighter. And when we were sparring, it was totally different because it was like, all right, it was like back and forth, me and him going. And everybody was just like, man, who is this kid? Like, who is this? And he was just like, man, he's like, man, you ain't no sparring partner. And I was just like, why you say that? He was like, dude, he was like, man, you a world champion. He was like, trust me.
From Omaha, Nebraska, Terence Crawford.
2 years later, the opportunity to finally break out came when he served as a fill-in opponent against Bradis Prescott and about televised on HBO.
Me going in there, my mind is straight. I'm physically, mentally prepared for whatever he was going to bring to the table. And I just went in there and just letting my talent and my skills speak for itself.
Still undefeated, Terence Crawford.
What a show for Terence Crawford.
A year later, Crawford became the mandatory challenger for the 135-pound title holder, Scotsman Ricky Burns, which meant his first championship fight would require a trip to Glasgow, Scotland.
He understood that if we gotta go over there and get that title, that's what we gotta do.
I didn't really have no fear of him fighting Ricky Burns, you know. He just seemed real confident, so that was no problem.
The new WBO lightweight champion of the world.
I still get excited talking about that moment because that's the highlight to my career. That's the highlight to my dreams coming true, is that one particular fight. Because that's what I've been working my whole life for. And that day, I captured it.
When Crawford returned home to Omaha, he enjoyed a hero's welcome from a large collection of family and friends. And winning the belt set the stage just 3 months later when he fought at home for the first time since the 2006 Golden Gloves tournament. His opponent was the highly touted Euriorkis Gamboa.
The Gamboa fight was the fight that boosted me from just a regular champion to about to be the man. You know, some people come up to me and was like, hey man, I'm not even gonna lie to you. I betted against you. I didn't think you was gonna beat that guy.
Wow, man, this is just something to be around, just the crowd, the fans, the city, everybody seeing who Terence Crawford was as a fighter. And that's when the city grasped onto him and said, okay, this is our champion. This is our belt.
Terence Crawford has fought four times since the Gamboa bout, winning decisively on each occasion, emerging as one of the biggest names in his sport. At 28 years of age, a perfect 28-0. All the while, he's continued to reside in Omaha, embracing the tranquility it can offer him. Staying here keeps him close to the figures who guided him this far, as well as those he's guiding himself.
Being a dad, for me, is the best thing that ever happened to me. Keeps me out of trouble. I love making my kids happy, and it just makes me feel good to know that, you know, they got somebody that they can count on. Oh, you got one.
He got a fish.
Already.
Fly.
First fish of the day.
Don't throw it back in. Please don't. Please don't. Please don't.
What you gonna do with it?
I'm gonna cook it and eat it. Daddy.
You caught the first fish of the day.
Daddy, why you let it go?
It's too little.
As his profile rose, Crawford's search for greater purpose and impact at home was bolstered by an unlikely journey thousands of miles away. It all began in 2014, when he reconnected with his fourth grade teacher, a woman named Jamie Nolette, who he'd learned had been leading mission trips to Africa.
Here I wanted to talk to him about how he's doing in boxing, and he just was like, tell me about Africa. What were you doing in Africa, and where are you going? And he's like, he asked me, he said, will you take me? I said, yeah, I'll take you. I'm like, when do you want to go?
I was just like, let's go in 2 weeks. She was laughing like, no, we can't go in 2 weeks. I was like, no, I want to go as soon as possible because I'm about to be training for a fight.
I had a team that was supposed to be going in September. We moved the trip up and ended up going like a month later in August to Africa together for the first time. Terence took it all in, and I could tell that it was very impactful. He just loved being with the kids. I mean, he was teaching them some of his boxing moves. We handed out jerseys. And I mean, he was so in it.
Crawford returned to Africa for a second trip a year later. For more volunteer work, that echoed a desire he'd been showing with increasing fervency in Omaha.
When I got shot and everything panned out the way it did and I came world champion, like, it was like my responsibility to keep winning and keep hope alive for the people that look up to me, that want to accomplish something in life.
This is the place he keeps that hope alive. The B&B Boxing Academy, founded in North Omaha by Crawford and Bryan McIntyre 3 years ago. In so many ways, a salute to his own beginnings.
B&B Boxing Academy stands for Bo and Bud. Terence Bud Crawford, Bryan Bo Mac McIntyre.
You gonna go to that other circle, that other line right there. When you get ready to turn, go.
Let's go!
Our gym sits right in the middle of the black community. We did that because we want to keep it right here where we started at. We started here, we want to finish here.
Anything we can do to get the kids off the streets and to help them, that's what we're about. It's free. We don't want to charge because we know how it is coming up.
There you go, not bad.
You come here, you train, you like it, so be it.
Chin up, go!
Downstairs, upstairs. You gotta step in with your punches, step in with your combinations. Let's go.
This is what I love to do. I love to be at the gym. I love to train kids. What else I'm gonna do? I can't steal. I can't cheat. I can't lie. I fucking can't murder nobody. But one thing I can do is teach a kid how to fight. You know what I'm saying?
Crawford and McIntyre are currently looking to expand the academy into an adjoining empty warehouse to allow more kids to participate. With the assistance of Jamie Nolet, they launched a $1.2 million capital campaign late last year.
I've learned along the way that if you really want to make a big impact, you kind of have to bring people alongside you who can help you. And so that's what I'm trying to do, is just come alongside him and help him expand his mission. And at the same time, try to guide him, to keep him humble and help him make good decisions.
But earlier this year, she watched her old student falter when police had to get involved after he had a dispute with a local auto body shop.
Well, I'm not perfect in no way, shape, or form. I'm still human. I still get angry. I still get mad. I just got to learn how to, deal with all the extra things that come with being who I am. There's going to be a lot of people that try to provoke me, that try to do things to get me to react in a certain way so they can file a lawsuit or whatever the case may be. I just gotta be smarter next time.
The situation has since been resolved, but the headlines it received gave the community an opportunity to embrace their hero in even a lesser moment. After all this time, it goes both ways. He looks out for the people he represents, and they pray he stays on the right path forward.
The sky is the limit for Bud. But he got to keep on staying focused, being humble, and continue to let God lead him. Sometimes you just got to put them blinders on and stay focused.
The principal focus for now is another unbeaten fighter, Victor Postol. He comes from Ukraine. He's trained by Hall of Famer Freddie Roach. And observers say their meeting July 23rd in Las Vegas could be the biggest test of Crawford's career.
I don't give a crying corn's ass who he got in this corner. It ain't gonna help you when that thunder start coming. I'll show him that B&B boxing in Omaha, Nebraska on the north side, dead in the ghetto, with way better team than they are.
And even as there's excitement for what's to come, it's also impossible not to marvel at his incredible reality.
It ain't no dream no more. It's real. It's real. It's just really real.
Go, bud. Go, bud. Go, bud.
I call my Crawford wall. You know, I kind of dedicated this whole wall to Terence Crawford here. It starts when he was 7 years old all the way up until he became a world champion. So I have pictures of him in the beginning, middle, and all the way up until he was a world champion. So this is a wall that was dedicated to him, you know, from our club.
I mean, he's a great fighter. When I get old, I'm gonna be like Bud from Omaha, Nebraska, when I turn pro.
Fuck, man, these kids look at Terence like he a god. The good part is he's still here. He hasn't went nowhere. That just goes to show you, you ain't gotta go to Hollywood. Hollywood come to you.
Like every boxer, he walks into the ring alone. Like only the most fortunate, his spirit is strengthened by so many others.
What God has told us is when we need you. All right.
This is Terence Bud Crawford. Where he comes from is who he is.
My life, it's always been a fight. Whether it was in the ring or outside the ring. And that's what it's all about, is facing adversity and going through those trials and tribulations and coming up the hard way. Because when you do that, that's when you appreciate it more. This is my fight, my life. And I believe I'm winning it right now.
Don't miss the live fight, Terence Crawford versus Victor Postol, Saturday night, July 23rd on HBO Pay-Per-View.